As most of you are probably aware, we've now turned to the music of Bach, and in particular his Well-Tempered Clavier, and this is the second program in the series. And listening to it, I find it quite fascinating, and something that I've never quite been able to resolve in my mind, how such an earthy gentleman as Bach can write such intellectual and heady music. I mean, was there something peculiar to that time that made that possible, or made that an easy thing for him to do?
It's a difficult question. I think volumes can be written upon that subject, the creative process. How integrated is it into the person? You said Bach, man of heady stock, earthy man. He went through what we would consider hell, actually. His life was very difficult in so many ways, as an administrator, as a person that at Leipzig, at the church he was cantor of. He was through a myriad of difficulties with the administrative aspects there. He fought very hard for his day-to-day existence. The evening would be given over to domestic bliss, and probably this was the finest part of his day. He had literally half an orchestra from the children that he spawned.
I think he begat 20, is that
yeah.
not so? Yeah.
Although many died. Mm-hmm. As we go through the programs, we will read the chronology of the family tree. What makes a man like Bach work so hard, so prolific, we don't know. His life was not conducive whatsoever in the outward forms to creating the Well-Tempered Clavier, the cantatas, the unbelievable amount of work which it was estimated would take a copyist 70 years just to copy out Bach's parts. Yet he was a teacher of Latin. He was responsible for four choirs in the city of Leipzig. He had to compose a cantata for Sundays.
Every Sunday a new one, or almost?
Yeah, yeah. Well, it wasn't, you know, that. There were over 300. However, he was there for 27 years in Leipzig. That was his last post from 1729. And, or 23. Before that, he had an easier life in the town of Kutchen, where he was Kapellmeister to a prince, and this is where he wrote most of his instrumental music, the Brandenburg Concerti, the first book of the Well-Tempered Clavier, the keyboard suites, and so forth. But getting really back to your question, what I don't think we yet understand, and possibly we never will, and in a way I hope we never do, the creative process. It can be integrated, as some people have it, and in others, no. Bach was basically uneducated. He spoke poorly. He could not express himself in many ways. His letters are few and far between. He gives us no indication of his personal life. He is a middle-class artisan, not thinking whatsoever about his genius or how good he is. He said, "I worked hard." I don't think he would have thought that his music would be surviving today, that we would be listening to it, that we would be in awe of it. One person wrote that Bach is the past, the present, and the future of music. I think we should stop talking and begin with the prelude and fugue in C-sharp minor, which Hutchison calls a magnificent composition justifying the comparison often made with the architecture of a Gothic cathedral, the prelude a dirge, tragically lyrical. And the fugue is extremely grave in mood, rising to a poignant climax, combining two subjects in double stretto. Let's hear Wanda Landowska in the C-sharp minor prelude and fugue from the Well-Tempered Clavier.
Thank you.
Prelude and Fugue number 4 in C sharp minor, in a performance by Landowska and the composer, of course, J.S. Bach. That was one of the most complex fugues of Book 1. Let's hear the same work in a performance by a pianist, Arthur Lesser. Thank you. late Arthur Lesser performing the C-sharp minor prelude and fugue, book one of the 48, the Well-Tempered Clavier. Let's hear a performance on clavichord, Ralph Kirkpatrick. Thank you. the C sharp minor prelude and fugue, book one from the Well-Tempered Clavier, and that was on the harp clavichord with Ralph Kirkpatrick. And I suppose we will go on shortly.
Yeah, we'll be back with David Dubal and today's program of musical offering in just a moment.
Moving along in the chromatic scale, we have come to the key of D major, fifth prelude and fugue. And the prelude is a toccata type. Many of Bach's preludes are. This one is a bubbling, spirited work. And the fugue is rather martial. Hutchison, in his book on the piano literature, wrote, "A young pianist once aptly said to me, she could march right up to the cannon's mouth if this fugue were played to her." Well, I hope she didn't. But it's a joyous prelude and fugue, beloved of students. I think that the prelude is often played like a Czerny study. Let's hear Rosalind Turek's performance on the piano. Thank you. Rosalind Turek in a very sober reading of the D major prelude. I don't know if that would send me to the mouth of a cannon. Of course, nothing would. Let's hear Richter in the D major prelude. Let's see if his tempos are different. Well, Richter's performance was fine. Nothing more. Although, yes, I like the tempo better in the... Your look, Matt, is...
No. I'm sorry. I wasn't going to say anything at all. I really like that very much.
I prefer Landowska, but we are now saving her for the last. Let's hear Kirkpatrick on the clavichord in the same prelude and fugue in D major.
Thank you.
On the clavichord, we heard the Prelude and Fugue in D major, Kirkpatrick, and now Wondolandowska in the D major Prelude and Fugue. I must hear that again, because I think that is the finest realization that we've heard today of it. Let's hear the prelude again in the hands of Landowska. Prelude and Fugue in D major, and I'm smiling now.
Well, closer to the canon, I think.
Yeah, you're right. She's inspiring. She conceived this, of course, as a French overture with the double dotting of the notes in the fugue. Notice that in her performance, the prelude is, although the technique of the right hand, you can hear every note, it's the left hand that she's bringing out. There's where the wit and the sparkle of the piece comes alive. And the other performances lacked a left hand.
Did Bach play the clavichord, and was there any recognition of how he was as a performer? I mean, he's writing very demanding music, obviously.
Oh, yes, yes.
I'm just wondering whether he could play it himself.
He could play everything himself. He, in his lifetime, was not known primarily, of course, as a composer, and we know that for, you know, decades his music had not been heard after his death. In large public circles.
Was it Mendelssohn who brought him back?
Mendelssohn, with the St. Matthew Passion in 1829, under the tutelage of his own teacher, Zelter, brought to the ears of that day the first Bach performance on a grander scale. Although the Well-Tempered had been played by other people, there were always a small group of people who kept Bach alive. But in his own day, Bach was known as the greatest keyboard player of the day, and his organ playing was astonishing, his harpsichord performances. Not by his music, but as an executant artist, was he really respected. Let's move on to the next prelude and fugue. We were in D major, we must now go to D minor, and the prelude is, it's very D minor.
Thank you.
Russian pianist Richter in the D minor prelude and fugue. To me, the prelude did not have enough intensity, and the fugue was played much too sweetly. I see this as a harsher work, with a few rays of lyricism. The piano sound is really terrible, Matt, you know? Brand new recording. I think that you said it was recorded far away.
It sounds to me like it was recorded in a large hall. And the Russians, depending on where they record, have a tendency to mic very far away because of, they might have the mic set up, say, for an opera, and then they go and roll a piano into the same place and it's mic'd from 4 feet away.
It's like this is recorded underwater. Let's hear Wonderlandowska in the D minor prelude and fugue, number 6 from the Well-Tempered Clavier. As it should be. A wonderful performance. Notice Richter ending small and soft, Landowska playing the piece in this harsher, rhythmical style. This is a great keyboard artist with such sensibilities to this composer. I personally detest the ending of any prelude and fugue almost in a small manner. We'll continue with the clavichord performance and go on with other preludes and fugues in their order.